Three very big and important topics: gift, calling, and work. Focusing on evangelism, right? The difference between gift and talent is this. When the Bible used the word gifts, it is spiritual in nature. Talents would be what God gives to everyone, regardless of whether you are a believer or unbeliever. Some people, for example, will have the talent to play the piano, the talent to draw, the talent to do many, many things in this world, whereby this world may continue to exist. So that will be talent. When a person becomes a believer, sometimes a talent can become a gift, but not all the time. Using the ability to play the piano as an example, a person may be very talented in playing the piano, and the person might even be a concert pianist. But he may or she may not be given the gift of playing the piano. What it means is simply this: the person doesn't stop having the ability to play the piano. But when you study the purpose of gifts, you realize that the purpose of gifts is for the profit withal. And so I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to refer to a few passages of the Bible because of the nature of the title. Right? There's no one passage that covers gift, calling, and ministry. So we're going to look at this passage, where you must understand the purpose and significance of God giving us gifts, after which we shall turn to Ephesians chapter 4, where we have the gift of an evangelist that will help us understand. Now, using the pianist as an example to complete the illustration, the person may still be able to play the piano. But the problem is this. The difference is this. When a person plays the piano as a talent, it is to make money. It is to draw attention to the pianist, because the person wants to be famous, the person wants to be well known, and so the manner in which the person plays will be to show how talented the pianist is. And so the profit is not so much for the blessing of others per se, that may be the byproduct, but primarily the aim and the goal is to promote the pianist. But in the case of the gift, it is for the benefit of others, period. That is why God gave gifts. It is purely for the profit of others. What kind of profit? Where the person can be more effective in worshiping God and in serving God, to help you to become more godly, more spiritual. That is the purpose of the use of spiritual gifts. And so when the person plays the piano, as a talented piano player, the person will play to draw attention to self. Whereas a person who is gifted in playing the piano, the person will play to become invisible, whereby he points people to Christ. He points people to God, because the purpose is to profit the others so that they will be better worshippers of God. And so sometimes you find that the two are opposing one another. You train 8-10 hours a day to draw attention to yourself, and then suddenly now you have to play in such a manner whereby all these other kinds of extras that you do when you play to draw attention to yourself has to stop immediately, so much so that when you play, you become invisible. People will have a better way of worship because of your play. So the person who may be talented in playing the piano may not have the gift in playing the piano. You understand the difference? So the gift is spiritual. And everyone who is born again is given at least one gift. Now these are some of the things you take note of as I read to you the first 11 verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Now you watch some of the truths that are found in this passage regarding gifts. Chapter 12 explains who give gifts, the purpose of gifts, and chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians tells us the motivation behind the use of gifts. Ephesians chapter 4 teaches us the result and the impact of the exercise of gifts. Combine the passages together, you will have a good understanding of the biblical teaching on spiritual gifts. Okay, so we look at this part first. Now you watch. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. So it is very important, because if you were to do a concordance search of this phrase, I would not have you ignorant. There are very few truths in the Bible where God specifically tells us, I don't want you to be ignorant. The other one, of course, is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Remember the passage that we use very often for vigil services regarding those who have died in Christ, so that you will not sorrow as if there is no hope. So it's a very interesting study if you can just simply see what are the things that God specifically told us, I don't want you to be ignorant of. And so the understanding of spiritual gift is significant and important enough to impact us, that God specifically tells us, don't be ignorant of this. It's not that he's saying you can be ignorant of other doctrines. He doesn't mean that. But he highlights certain important truth that it is very significant and important that we know. Now, one of the problems in the church in Corinth is schism, fighting. Alright, a lot of cliques. Now you watch. Ye know what ye were, that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led, describing when they were not born again. Wherefore I give you to understand, alright, that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus a curse, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. Now these are the diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. So he's saying, if you are truly born again, as verse 3 tells us, if the Spirit of God lives in you, okay, you are born again. So therefore, everyone who is born again, something has happened into your life regarding spiritual gifts. Diversities of gifts, many different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. Differences of administrations, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operations, but it is the same God. Now in 3 verses, the Apostle Paul established, number 1, God the Father is involved in giving gifts. God the Son is involved in giving gifts. God the Spirit is involved in giving gifts, right? You see this? Spirit, verse 4. The Lord, second person of the Godhead, verse 5. First person of the Godhead, the Father, verse 6. You see this? Which worketh all in all. So whenever it comes to gift, don't say, well, I got my gift from the Father, you got yours from the Son, you got yours from the Spirit. That was probably the problem in the church in Corinth, and so he established the theology. So whatever gift you receive, it comes from the three persons of the Godhead in united agreement. So don't quarrel, don't fight. That's number 1. So the source of all our gifts comes from the three persons in the Godhead, even though the Spirit now may be the one who is described as the one who is giving us the gift. Alright, but the three persons in the Godhead, they are all behind it. That's the first thing you have to observe. Every believer will have gifts, and the three persons in the Godhead are all involved in deciding who gets what gift. Now, look at verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. So, spiritual gifts is known as the manifestation of the Spirit of God in a person's life. So when you exercise your spiritual gift, it is to show the Spirit of God dwells in you. Okay? And the Bible says, to every man to profit withal. So it is for the purpose of blessing others. So when I use the gift, with the help of God, I am now called a co-laborer of God, serving the Lord. And you who receive the gift will be called the building that I am building, co-laboring together with God. Alright? When you use your gift and I am blessed by your use of the gift, then at that point in time when you use your gift, you are co-laboring with God. Then when I am blessed by your gift, I become the building. And that is the basis for this verse in 1 Corinthians chapter... Let me see. 1 Corinthians, see how forgetful I am. Chapter 3, verse 9. 1 Corinthians 3:9. You see? For we are laborers together with God. So when you are using your gift, you are laborers together with God, right? And then at the same time, ye are God's husbandry, that is the building. Ye are God's building. You understand? That is how we can be both laborer and building at the same time. When I exercise my gift, I'm a laborer. You be the building, receiving my gifts, the exercise of my gifts. Right? You are blessed by my use of the gift. When you use your gift, I am blessed by your use of the gift. And so at the same time, I'm the building, I'm the husbandry. So we are both in the church. We are co-laborers with God, and at the same time, we are building. The building that is being blessed, being built up. Now this is how you must look at the church in terms of the use of spiritual gifts. You and I are both laborers and the building that is built up at the same time. And that's why it is called profit with all. So who therefore is able to tell you what gifts you have? The people who receive the gifts when you use them. And when they are blessed by it, then they will tell you that you have the gift. So people can help you identify your gifts. Now of course, the people who help you identify the gifts must also be mature enough to know how to identify. Okay? So please bear that in mind. I mean, somebody told me that so-and-so is a good speaker, we can invite him to be our church camp speaker. And so I invited, and then I made the biggest boo-boo of my life in terms of inviting camp speaker, because subsequently I found out that he's a terrible camp speaker, he allegorizes the Bible and so forth. Then I have to get permission from the BOE to write a letter to rescind the invitation, and that person now is very angry with me. Okay? So my big mistake was this. I thought this person knows how to evaluate what a good speaker or bad speaker was. And so I trusted this person's word, and that was my mistake. So when we talk about profit with all, we have to understand that the people who receive the blessing of someone who exercises his spiritual gift, you must know how to evaluate also. So not just anyone will say, okay, this person has this gift, this person, it's not so simple. You're going to still use your brain to check and see whether this person really know how to evaluate or not. Okay? So it is for the blessing of others, that's the use of gift. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge, and so on. And you go all the way down to verse 11. But all these worketh the one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. So the final lesson that we learn is this. The gifts are for the blessing of others, and finally, the Spirit of God, which means God the Father, God the Son also, He decides who gets what gift or gifts. In other words, you cannot pray for the gift. It's given to you. You cannot ask for it. You cannot pray for it. So therefore, our duty is to discover what gift or gifts God the Holy Spirit has given to me. You cannot pray for it. You cannot say, well, I pray for the gift of preaching. You cannot. You cannot pray for something. You cannot ask for it. The Bible says so. He decides as He will, not as you will, as the Spirit will. Okay, bear that in mind. So therefore, you don't be envious of others. And whatever gift you have, you thank God for it, and you develop it, and you use it for the blessing of others. And if you are used by God for the blessing of others, since it is a gift, you don't be arrogant, you don't be proud, you just simply thank God. And everyone must do their part. The remaining verses of chapter 12 tells us how important it is, using the illustration of a human body to help us. So now the question is this, is evangelism part of this spiritual gift? Right? Is it part of spiritual gift? That means somebody can say, well, I was not given the gift of evangelism, so therefore I don't have to evangelize. I'm not sure whether you have read this article written by a particular pastor of a particular church, whereby he wrote in his pastoral page one of the Lord's Day. And then he said, I do not want you, my congregation members, to feel bad or feel guilty if you don't evangelize. Because he says that the gift of evangelism is only reserved for the evangelists and the pastors. And so therefore, as an ordinary member, you don't have this gift, and therefore you are not duty bound to go out and evangelize. It is okay. Because if I don't tell you this, and you don't evangelize because you think that you have to evangelize, you will feel very bad. You feel guilty. So I don't want you to feel guilty. So let me assure you, you don't evangelize, it's okay. It is for the pastor and for the evangelist. That's what it means by spiritual gift. Now, is that true? That church cannot grow. That's problem number one, right? How to grow? Nobody evangelizes. I'm as a pastor, how do I evangelize? I have no friends outside. I got no friends outside, you know, because I don't work. How do I have friends outside? All my friends that I had who are non-believers were friends that I made when I was working or when I was in the university. But other than that, how do I make friends who are non-believers? All my friends are church members, church people, right? Other than my brothers and sisters, my relatives who are unbelievers, there are no unbelievers in my life. Very few. You will have a lot, but he says you don't have to evangelize. So how does the church grow? Well, two ways. Number one, get the wives have a lot of babies. And so the pastor, I think, has five children. Seriously, we study church growth, right? Giving birth is one of the ways, you know, to have church growth. Okay? Second way to grow is to go to other churches and fish from their aquarium. I mean, there's the other way. I mean, if I want my church to grow, I don't want to go to charismatic churches, right? Because charismatics, they are not the good fish. They are the bad fish. So the closest good fish that they could go to fish would be the BP churches. And so that's what they did. So one day I received a phone call from Reverend Das. Reverend Das said, hey, do you know so? So yeah, I know so. And so he used to be in our church, but now he's in the other church whereby they believe this and this. Hey, this person comes to my church every Sunday after service, he just speak to one family, and then after speaking to the family, he just walked out. And he has been doing this for the past few Sundays, you know. I say, Das, I think he's trying to fish from your aquarium. I think you better talk to him. And so the following Sunday, Reverend Das talked to him and tell him, please stop it. And so he never came back. Not at all. Your church will not grow if you do not evangelize. Now, of course, we do not say we evangelize just to have church growth. All right? But that is the impact, that is the result. So if you see evangelism as that kind of spiritual gift, then you're probably not evangelized. Not at all. But then we do have one particular passage in the Bible that talks about evangelists, isn't it? And that must bring us to Ephesians chapter 4. Right, so how do we understand Ephesians chapter 4? Now, of course, the list of gifts that are found in Ephesians 4, you do not find them in 1 Corinthians 12. That means the list in 1 Corinthians 12 is not meant to be comprehensive or exhaustive, right? Likewise, the list in Ephesians chapter 4. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, and he gave, that is Christ, okay, after he saved us, in the case of 1 Corinthians 12, the Spirit of God is the one who gives. But here we have Christ. He gave some apostles. Now we know, right? Just because one person of the Godhead is described as giving, actually it's all three persons of the Godhead, okay? 1 Corinthians 12 make that clear. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and some teachers. Now the phrase evangelist, that's where evangelism comes from, simply means the good news. And an evangelist in particular is a person who has the ability to preach the gospel in a manner that is very dynamic, very effective. That's an evangelist, okay? As opposed to a pastor. A pastor is not an evangelist in this sense. Let me explain. An evangelist, his primary purpose and goal and aim is to preach the gospel to save sinners who are not born again. A pastor's role includes preaching the gospel to unbelievers, but also to teach the whole counsel of God to other believers. You see the distinction? So you have the evangelist whose specialty is in preaching the gospel to sinners. That's it. Whereas the pastor and the teacher, that's why he is called pastor teacher, is to preach the gospel to sinners as well as to feed the flock of Christ, the rest of the Bible, so that he will become mature in the faith. And that's why these gifts The Bible tells us in verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints. Now evangelists cannot do that. So evangelists and pastors combined together will be able to achieve that. Of course, the apostles and prophets, these are the capital A apostles, capital A prophets, sorry, capital P prophets. They are the ones that God used to give us the Bible. No more. Okay? Prophets in the general broad sense, yes, they are still. Prophets are people who foretell and foretell. As long as you foretell, that means your foretelling is based upon the Bible, such as Jesus is returning soon, that is future foretelling. You are fine. You don't go and say future things that are totally outside of the Bible, that is called false prophecy. No more. Foretell means you preach against sin. So these are the twin ministries of the prophet. If you do that, then you are still called a small p. Not a capital P. Capital A, capital P, no more. Alright? But small a in the general sense, when you are sent out by the church to be a missionary in this country, then you can be called a small a apostle. Because this small a apostle is used to describe Barnabas when the church in Jerusalem sent him to do missionary work. And that's what he was called. A small a apostle. That is fine. But because we do not want to confuse it today, we don't use it. We call the person a missionary instead. Apostle means someone who has been sent. A prophet is someone who will foretell and foretell the word of God. But our focus is on evangelists. So he is a specialist in the preaching of the gospel. And there are such people who have this ability. I would call men like Dr. John Sung an evangelist. He has a special ability to preach the gospel. You read his sermons that have been translated into English for us. If you know how to read Mandarin, please read the sermons in Mandarin. You will get the flavor much better than the translated one. I can only read the translated one. I can't read Mandarin. And by reading the translation of his sermons, you realize his ability to bring the gospel is tremendous. Now, the person who has both evangelistic skill and the skill of a pastor, I believe, is Spurgeon. John Sung does not have the skill of a pastor. He's not a pastor, he's an evangelist. To be a pastor, you have to stay put in one place. Spurgeon was able to do both very, very well by the power of God. You read his sermons on salvation. It is tremendous. It is so illuminating. And the way he reasoned, it is so convincing. Very, very good. And then he also is able to build up the faith. You read his commentary on Romans and all the other major commentaries on the epistles of the Bible, you find that it is very rich. So he has the ability to do both. Bring in the gospel to unbelievers, and then after they are born again, he also knows how to have the pastor's heart to keep on teaching and teaching and teaching the word of God to build up their faith. Alright? Basically, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, so that we all will come together in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure, the stature, the fullness of Christ, so that we will not be tossed to and fro. Now that is the purpose of gifts. Now coming back to this evangelism. Now we know that there are special gifts given to evangelists. Now the question is this. We admit that there are evangelists. But does that mean that because we are not evangelists, we are excused from giving the gospel? That is the key. We all know that not all of us are evangelists. That we have to admit. Not all of us have all the gifts. We all are given different gifts. But does that mean that we all cannot go out and give the gospel? Not so. Spiritual gifts, the Holy Spirit decides who gets. And we admit that to be a special evangelist, it is a spiritual gift specifically given to a select few that God Himself has anointed, has chosen. We don't deny that. And that will also therefore become their calling to be an evangelist. That was exactly what John Sung did everywhere he went. He did not stay put in one place to be a pastor of any church. He moved around to many parts of this part of the world to do the work of an evangelist, to preach against sin, and some people may even call him a revivalist. To me, I see them as synonyms. You are dead in sin, so he revived you by giving the gospel, and therefore you are now spiritually alive. I don't like to use the word revival inside the church, unless the church is also filled up with a lot of sinners and regenerated people. So I don't like to use the word revival, because unless you say the person is spiritually dead, you don't have to revive him. Or if he's not spiritually dead, he's wayward, don't use revival. Use wayward. Because you say that he's born again, but he's strayed away from the Lord. Unless you say he's not born again, then you use revival. Right? Because you don't revive somebody who is still alive. Right? How many of you seen a lifeguard drag a person out of the swimming pool while he's still swimming properly? Right? Then you give him more to more. Hey, friend, I'm still alive. What are you doing to me? But the person who is drowning, you drag him out of the pool and then his heart stops beating, you revive him, right? You do everything possible to revive him because he's dead. Or his heart stopped beating. So if we are spiritually alive, don't revive me, I'm okay. But if I'm wayward, okay, you tell me I'm wayward, fine, I accept that. Alright, so, ministry of evangelism. That is different from the ministry of an evangelist. Okay, so let's look at evangelism. Now, which passage do you think is most suitable for the teaching on evangelism? None other than the Great Commission, isn't it? Matthew 28, 18 to 20, and we are going to contrast this with the last few verses of Mark chapter 16, verse 15 to verse 18. Now, the person who said you don't have to go out and evangelize and so on would say that the Great Commission is only for the disciples and for them only. And they will say that the commission given to the disciples in Mark 16 confirms that. But if you compare Mark 16 verse 15 to 18, you realize it is very different from Matthew 28, 18 to 20. Very different. The context is different. Now, before we look at Matthew 28, a more familiar passage, it is more familiar than I believe the passage in Mark, isn't it? We have to look at Mark first, okay? You put your finger to Matthew 28, 18 to 20, but we turn to Mark 16, 15 to 18. All right? Now you look at the context of Mark 16, verses 15 to 18. The context is in verse 14. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as he sat at meat and upbraided them. He scolded them. Upbraided means he scolded them for their unbelief and hardness of heart. Now we are talking about the 11 disciples, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. So this would be the very early part of the encounter between Christ and the disciples. Those who have seen Christ came and told them. Context, the two men from Emmaus, Mary and the ladies. And the 11 refused to believe. And so the Lord rebuked them. And he said to them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Now this is a specific assignment given to these capital A apostles. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe, not us, you guys, you 11. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them, they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Now these are all the signs that the apostles did. You can find them in the book of Acts. Alright, they did, and they experienced this. Why did God say this to them? Because they did not believe. Why did God single them out? Because they are the ones who must continue what the Lord Jesus Christ has started when he came down to earth. They must continue on the work of Christ by the formation of the local church. If they do not do this, there will be great disaster. Now, how to get them to be the ones who will succeed in the formation of the local church? Because the formation of the local church is to replace the visible witness on earth that used to be the nation of Israel. And now God said, no more. I don't want Israel to be my witness anymore. Why? Because I sent my prophets They hurt them. They persecuted them. And now finally, when I send my son, they crucified him. They rejected him. I cannot use the nation anymore to be my witnesses. And a lengthy theological explanation is given by the Apostle Paul in Romans 9 and 10. Okay, you can read that for yourself. And so the local church will now replace Israel. But the local church is a church that must be made up of all kinds of believers. Jews, Samaritans, and Gentiles. Now these are the only three kinds of people on earth that God sees. Everyone who is not half Jew or Jew will be called Gentiles. So everyone under the sun who is not Jewish in any way will be called Gentiles. So Chinese are Gentiles, Africans are Gentiles, Koreans are Gentiles, everyone, Europeans are all Gentiles. Okay? And then the next group, the Samaritans, and then the Jews, they all hate one another. So how to make sure that when God started the local church as his now new witnesses on earth, that they must be, number one, united. They must all be united, but at this juncture, they can't stand one another. The Jews look down on the Samaritans, and the Jews look down on the Gentiles, and vice versa. So how to get them to love one another and help one another? And furthermore, how to get them to submit to God? God's teaching. Founding the church is easy. Keeping the church united is hard. So they need the future teaching. We call them the epistles now, right? Epistles were written to solve a lot of church problems. How to get them to accept that these 11 disciples, all 10 of them deserted Christ except for John. How to get the church to submit to their authority. So God had to use gifts specially given to them to authenticate that we are legitimate representatives of the Lord Jesus Christ on this earth to continue on the work that he has stopped, that he has started and ascended, and we must continue. And so they were given these special abilities. So the content, in other words, of the passage in this commission, we know that in the case of Mark 16, verse 15 to 18, it is a specific commission given to the apostles for the establishment and the founding of the local church. And that must also include the preaching of the gospel, which they did. That's what Peter did the first time in Acts chapter 2. He preached the gospel. That's why there are similarities between this passage and Matthew 28. But you and I must also take special note of the differences. This in Mark 16, 15 to 18, these verses are specifically for the apostles to commission them to do the work of Christ, to continue the work of Christ for the founding of the church. Whereas in Matthew 28, it's still to the disciples because they were the believers around. Now you watch, turn to Matthew 28, verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Now the content itself tells us that even though it is given to the disciples, of course they were the ones in charge, but the content is the one that defined the scope. In the case of Mark 16, the content tells us that the scope is limited only to the apostles for the establishment and the founding of the local church, in order to authenticate their apostolic ministries, whereby they will subject themselves to the authority of the apostles after the churches were formed. God knew there would be church situation, church problems. How are they going to fix their problems? Look to my chosen apostles. They will write epistles. They are the ones whom I have chosen to help you solve and deal with all your church issues and problems. But Matthew 28, you realize the content will tell you that this is a general commission to all believers, to future church leaders, to future Christians, the content is the one that will determine whether it is a reference to the gift of evangelism, which is specifically for certain evangelists, where they are very apt and very able in preaching the gospel, like Spurgeon and Johnson. But this is the Great Commission, and so therefore, evangelism, I would not call it as a spiritual gift. Because if you use it as a spiritual gift, then it is going to be very limited and localized. I would call evangelism just like prayer. Prayer is not a gift. There's no such thing as a special gift. Certain people are specially gifted in prayer. There's no such thing. Prayer is for everybody. Fasting is for everybody. Tithe and offering is for everybody. Same for this. Please understand. Evangelism is for all. Special, specific spiritual gifts. Yes, there are some who are very good in evangelism. They are called evangelists. But the general sharing of the gospel and the testimony is for every one of us. And you find this thread throughout the epistles. Where the Apostle Paul says, you go out and then you tell the world. When the Bible tells us, for example, in 1 Corinthians. You remember 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I believe. I think it's chapter 5. Yes. Verse 9. I wrote unto you an epistle not to company with fornicators, yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or with the extortioners, or with the idolaters of this world. For then must ye needs go out of the world. Right? He tells us as believers, we are to go out and fellowship with the covetous, with the extortioners, with the idolaters of this world. Otherwise, I would might as well take you out of this world. The reason why God saved us and allowed us to remain on earth is to so much so that we can go out and interact with the covetous, the extortioners, idolaters of the world, so that we can witness and tell them about Christ. But now I have written unto you not to company if any man that is called a brother be a fornicator. So this is biblical separation. So biblical separation is not isolation. So if you say that we cannot evangelize, cannot share the gospel, no need to share the gospel, then God might as well take us out of this world. God wants us to interact with the people of this world who are in sin, so that they will find salvation in Christ. And that's why evangelism is for all. Not to deny the fact that there are certain ones who are specially given the ability to make the gospel come alive in great power. They are called evangelists. So, gift, calling, and ministry of evangelism. I do not see it as a special spiritual gift when you use the word evangelism. When you use the word evangelist, yes, there are certain ones who are like that. We are all given the same commission as far as evangelism is concerned, to be a witness, to tell the people about Christ. The ministry of evangelism is for everyone. The gift of evangelism, if you do not equate the word gift under chapters 1 Corinthians chapter 12 as a special spiritual gift, you can use it in a very loose and general sense, then it is for everybody. But I will not use it as a general sense. Any question?
What about calling?
Calling. The Great Commission is for everybody. Just like you cannot say, well, we are all called to pray without ceasing. Pray always, right? Is that a calling? Normally a calling is very specific, like called to be single, called to be married, called to be full-time ministry, called to be a school teacher, called to be a professor, called to be a bus driver. So it's more localized, more specific, more particular. So you normally don't say, pray without ceasing as a calling. It's for everybody. So calling is normally very localized and specific. So if I rank the Great Commission, like pray without ceasing in everything, give thanks, rejoice evermore, it's for everybody, every believer. So I won't call it calling in that biblical usage. In a very loose general sense, everybody, if everybody is called to be a Christian or the elected ones, then in a loose general sense, you would do that, but theologically, I would not use it. Because the word call is very specific. Then it can be very confusing. Anything else? Yes?
Is there a difference between the gift of evangelist and the office? Is there office?
There's no office. You see, the person who has the ability to explain the gospel extremely well, he will be called an evangelist. I don't think a church government would have the office of an evangelist. You have the office of a pastor. That's it.
So
teacher.
A pastor can have a gift of evangelist.
Correct. Like Spurgeon. You read his sermons. My sermons are fantastic about the salvation. I'm reading about his explanation of faith, his explanation of the difference between how to save by grace or save by faith. The way he explained it is very, very clear and very good. The illustrations that he used is so apt and so accurate. Fantastic. I learned a lot from him by reading all this. Very useful. But an office of, like, in the church, you know, church government, you don't find it because we don't find it in the pastoral epistles. There are no qualifications of an evangelist. The qualifications of a deacon, qualifications of an elder, but no qualifications of an evangelist. That's why we don't have them as like a office. Okay? Yes?
Actually, when we are in the ministry of the evangelism, say now you are telling us that when we evangelize, we are not exercising a spiritual gift. It is it is normal.
See, when you say normal, just like, you got to use your words very carefully. It's not normal. I mean, you want to rank it as for all. Don't say normal. Okay? There are certain responsibilities that are given and trusted to everyone. Okay? But not everyone is given a particular spiritual gift. The activities that are for every believer would be praying without ceasing, tithe and offering, evangelism will be categorized together with for all believers. And then on the other side, when you talk about spiritual gifts, they are very different. Because the Spirit is the one who decides who gets what gift, isn't it? It's not for me to pray for it. I can't pray for it. Now, as a church, you can pray for gifts. But as an individual, you cannot. Because the last few verses of 1 Corinthians 12 tells us, pray for spiritual gifts. That means, as a church, you don't have a pastor. You can pray for a pastor. In that sense, as a church, you can pray for spiritual gifts. You don't have a pianist. You can pray that God will bring a Christian pianist. But as an individual, you can't pray for your gifts. As a church, you can pray for people with certain gifts that will help your church to get better and better. That you can do. You follow? Okay? So if you want to make it easier, you can tabulate into one particular column for all believers. Then the other one is the spiritual gifts that the Spirit of God decides for different believers.
Just when you categorize evangelists, in your mind it's only Spurgeon. It seems like it's only Spurgeon.
I'm just using that as two examples that I can remember.
But isn't there a spectrum from person who obeys the Great Commission to evangelize, and God gives certain people along the way obedience to evangelize. And so much that those who are, when you contrast them with those who are not evangelizing, it seems like they are like evangelists. But actually, they're just doing their part as a Christian. And do you think that there are people
You repeat what you said at the beginning.
Okay, two questions. Is there a spectrum of gifts of the evangelism, of the evangelist?
When you say spectrum, I think you mean...
High grade.
Yeah, correct. Different degrees are different
and also
categories, okay?
Yeah.
When you look at people who have gifts, let's say use evangelists, okay? There are some very good evangelists, there are some not so good evangelists, there are some average evangelists, and that's the question, isn't it?
I think that's...
Is that what you're saying?
What I mean is, to you, I mean, to some, it may be low-grade evangelists, but I think these gifts come from God. So God is the one who gives gifts, and some despise work to children, for example. They say, oh, these are work to children. But do you know that they are doing a very good work evangelizing to the children, and they seem to have an ability to reach out to children through evangelism? Do you consider them also a type of evangelist?
Okay, so now your question.